Good morning, everyone. Good morning, Sage.
Good morning. Do we know if Intel's coming today?
If who is?
Intel?
Intel? I don't know.
They had planned on it a couple weeks ago, but I haven't
I
heard any
haven't,
from them.
yeah, I haven't heard anything from them either. All right, let's maybe move through the pull request and we'll see if they join or not. All right, let's see. Piotr has a new pull request here for copyless rights and libretos. It looks like Matt and Halmai have looked over it. That sounds exciting. There's this improve the performance of PG to acting OSDs. It looks like Sage, you must have taken a look at this.
It's a very small optimization,
Okay.
but I'll go in shortly.
Cool. And then Sage, there's your reworked column family support PR. I admit I actually haven't looked at what you changed in that. Maybe I can get a chance to test it here soon. Is that something I assume post-Kraken?
I'm sorry, which one is this?
Your column family support rework PR.
I mean, it's unclear if we need to merge it at all until we actually show that it is helping. I don't want
Yeah.
that complexity.
It is nice to get the stats per thing we're doing. If that itself is kind of a win, but
But we can
yeah.
do that with a hack or whatever, with a test branch.
Good. Cool. Let's see what else what merged. Oh, this hints for Rados bench. That'll be nice.
That merged.
Yeah, that's good. A couple other things get closed due to inactivity. So if you are the author of any of those and feel like that shouldn't have been done, feel free to reopen and comment. What else? There's a couple other things that we're holding off on for Kraken. This RTC PR. There's a couple of different PRs from Dan Lambright that are here that Matt has been reviewing. Some of those, specifically the RCU stuff, hopefully will be through Tutology soon. And I told Dan I'd take it for a spin and see if we could see any interesting effects from it, both in terms of high concurrency IOPS testing and then also low concurrency latency testing. So that will be interesting to see if anything shows up. Yeah, that's about it here. I think the only other thing I had was. For Blue Store, we are considering switching to the bitmap allocator for BlueFS. In the short running test that I've been doing, I don't see much difference, but in the long running test for like 4K random writes, it seems like consistently I see higher performance with the bitmap allocator rather than the stupid allocator. It would be really, really swell if someone else could produce results that show the same thing. So far, I'm the only one seeing it, which makes me a little nervous. So if anyone is interested in that, send me an email and we can figure out how to set up tests to try to replicate it. Otherwise, that's about all I have this week. Let's see, did anyone from Intel join?
I don't see anybody.
Yeah.
Oh, there's Tushar. Tushar, are you gonna up for percentage day?
You're on mute, by the way, just in case you know that. All right, for now, does anyone else have anything that they would like to discuss this week?
Hey, Mark, this is James from Alibaba.
Yes.
Since you talk about the Blue Store, and here we have another bench against the Blue Store. And we have some interesting data to be shared. And also we have some questions regarding to their latency, especially for the Blue Store with RocksDB against MME device. We found some interesting data. So basically, so far we don't have we don't have time to put all the data into slides. So I just want to share right now with you guys. I'm looking for your advice. Okay. So we run the FIO bench with 16 bytes for write, 16 bytes as IO. The Q depth actually is one. Basically, we want to benchmark the latency. And we have three replicates for sure. And the SSD we are using actually a SATA SSD for RocksDB, war and RocksDB itself actually use against the SATA SSD. And the data block itself actually we use the MME SSD. And the latency we got so far for 16 bytes write. Actually, it's around 1.2 milliseconds. We do the latency breakdown for your reference regarding to the background why we care about the latency, just because our workload so far, probably I already share with Sage, our workload is especially for the OTCP and ORTP, sorry, and we care about the latency. And the 1.2 actually milliseconds is worse than than FileStore. For the FileStore, we have a same setup and same hardware, same setup, and then we can get a 0.8 millisecond latency. So I'm not sure whether you guys have any of the benchmark regarding to the latency.
My first suggestion would be to make sure that the BlueStore is preconditioned. The way that the RocksDB does its wall, it has to have cycled through and written several of its wall files before it can start overwriting. And until then, the latency will be higher. So make sure it's done that. I think latest master is tuned so that it has high enough value for that, but I actually am not. Let me look.
Okay, and we do the further analysis, and so far, if we're going to do one copy, just one copy instead of three replicates, just do one replicates, we can narrow down the latency to 0.65 milliseconds, and then we do further latency breakdown. We found out if the latency among the networking actually is going to be 200 microseconds, and we figure out if we only do the one duplicates, the latency for RocksDB is around 300 microseconds, and writing to the block MME device, deep block device, actually is going to be 100 microseconds, and then since you're going to do the replicates, right, and the replicates probably going to take like a 400 to 500 microseconds. It's where a little bit, and we do similar stuff with the FileStore latency breakdown, and we found out the FileStore journaling, since we use the MME device for journaling, and the latency actually is going to be like a 200 microseconds. So whenever they write journaling, right, they're going to return immediately. And MME device is faster than SATA SSD. It's possible the reason, and we still do the further analysis. Right now, we try to switch the we switch the device, we're going to use the MME device for RocksDB and use the SATA device for the you know, the data block. And we will see how it's going to perform.
So these were 4K random writes of 16 bytes with FIO.
Sorry. It's going to be 16K bytes write.
Oh, okay, 16K bytes, not 16 bytes.
16K write.
Okay.
And it's queued up to one.
Random write.
So I think the difference here is that in the file store case, the whole 16K is going to go into the journal, and so you're going to do a single IO to the device, and once that comes back, then it'll acknowledge it. Whereas with Blue Store, you're going to do 16K to the data portion, and then once that's stable, then you're going to journal just the metadata. And then so we're going to do two IOs, and one of those IOs is going to be to the slow device. So you can fix this, quote unquote, by changing your min alloc size to be something larger than 16K, in which case it'll do data journaling because it's below the threshold. So if you set min alloc size to say 32K, then your 16K will go straight to the wall. If it's an overwrite, if it's not an overwrite, it's still going to go to the data device. So, I mean, we can introduce tunables to like make this optional behavior that if you want to do more data journaling and more read write amplification, in order to get that lower latency, then it can do it. But I think it's important to understand what exactly the goal is here. Is the in your real workload, are the writes always going to be 16K?
Most likely, yes.
Okay. And you want, are they going to be overwrites or are they going to be writes to a new region of the object?
It's going to be a random write. It's going to be including their overwrite and also probably lots of going to be new update as well. Okay. New write as well.
The overwrites already. So, I mean, maybe what we really want to do is just have a separate tunable in Blue Store that says if your write is below some threshold, then just do data journaling. Don't do the IO at first, but just put it in the journal.
So put it in the journey, put it into the
regardless of what your min alloc size is, regardless of all the other stuff, we'll do a wall entry, and so you'll get that low latency for that small, right?
Okay. Sage, adding new performance tuning parameters scares me, especially when people don't understand what they do.
That would be great.
Yeah, I mean, the data journaling versus do the IO, then wait, and then metadata journaling, whatever, is sort of, it's tied to the min alloc size. And it does that because we basically only do data journaling when we absolutely have to in order for data integrity. But I think adding a single knob for, so that you can do data journaling for some other reason, because the IO is just small. Seems fine. I mean, we can set it at zero, so most people won't do this, but
Yeah, so is that how are we going to get in touch with you to add this tune parameter? We definitely want to have a try. And what's your plan?
I mean, email SephDevel is the way to do it. I have to look at the code. Let me put this on this list. We're sort of focused on getting the Kraken out the door, so I don't know that I can look at this week.
Okay, I'm definitely going to send you an email, and also going to share with you some data we already connect with either FastStore and BlueStore. Okay. And cool.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay.
Just send it to the list. For now, you can actually go ahead with 16K min alloc size, right? So that should improve your latency. And I would say that put the wall device on some faster device, like probably NVRAM or something. So you'll definitely see the latency improvement in that case. I have some data on that, so it should be.
Yeah, you actually have to set the min alloc size to be bigger than 16K. So you'd want to set it at 32K.
Yeah.
So if you, I mean, right now you can just see what would happen if you set malloc size at 32K and make sure you're doing overwrites. Then you'll see what will happen.
Sage, for write application, are you primarily worried about endurance of the media, or are you primarily worried about kneecapping throughput?
I mean, all of the above. We just want to avoid double writing data in general.
Well, they're pretty distinct cases, right? If it's the throughput case and you know for sure that the device currently is underutilized, then you could easily have a heuristic that shows to optimistically write to the journal and do most of the work later.
Mm-hmm.
You probably want to add that kind of feedback anyway.
So dynamically decide whether to do data journaling based on...
I mean, it's probably as simple as start by adding a counter that tells you the, I don't know, the 5 second, 30 second, and 5 minute average completion latencies. Mm-hmm. Need a way to get the baseline, but you could easily config in the expected commit latency for the device. And as it climbs above, let's say twice, you always do the most throughput optimized thing. But if it dips below that, you do the latency optimized thing.
Yeah. That would make sense. It would have to be sensitive to whether it's a durability endurance thing.
Yeah. Well, the durability case is completely different. If you're worried about that, then you always have to do the minimum write application thing.
Yeah. Most of the write amp is coming from compaction and RocksDB and not from the journaling. So I think
that was the thought I had, Sage, is compaction kind of screws this up, our guesses.
Well, I mean, it doesn't screw it up, but it does. If you're concerned, if you're looking at write amp, then it sort of dwarfs this, I think.
Totally dwarfs it.
Yeah. But if you're looking at latency, then like who cares about the write amp? It's on the slow device and it's asynchronous. So. Yep. Okay. Yeah, Alan, the Zeta scale is sounding better and better. But
it was always the long term winner. The question was how much work does it take to get it to cross over? And I think I got my fingers crossed that we're getting there. Okay. It really doesn't take a lot of energy to realize that the write amp for the random write case in RocksDB is always going to be awful. So, you know, if you care about small block performance, the rocks is sort of never really going to get you into the ballpark of being competitive.
Yeah.
It should work fine for, you know, large objects and, you know, object oriented stuff, but, you know, but for block stuff, you know, it's just not going to get you there.
Yep.
So,
yeah. And I think the way this is going to play out is that if you, and this is sort of where people are going anyway, but if you're doing small IO workloads, then you want to be using Flash anyway. And so you're going to use something like Zettascale.
Yeah.
You're not, so I'm less concerned about making small block random IO optimal on hard disks because you shouldn't be doing that. But I think for like mixed block workloads where it's not all 4K random IOs, but it's like, you know, some big IOs and some 128K IOs and whatever, just all over the place. I think it's
good. Well, then you got Amdahl's law. And you're back in the crapper.
Amdahl's law.
Yeah, you're going to be dominated by the slow part.
Yeah.
Alan, remind me what's the plan for Zettascale with BlueFS?
Well, the long-term plan was to put Zettascale on top of BlueFS, and I think the reality is that maybe, you know, some after my doc could comment better. I don't think that long-term plan has come to fruition yet. Basically, we've still been scrambling to get the basic performance and stayed focused on that. You know, my assumption has been until we're in striking distance on that, nobody in the rest of the community is going to care much. And I think that getting a Zscale on top of BlueFS, along with all the support tools in the rest of the infrastructure, you know, all the scripts and all the rest of that, and the provisioning tools and all the rest of that, that needs to be a community effort. I'm just skeptical of our ability to get that done efficiently on our own.
Sure.
So I, you know, so I think just those.
I think until the once the performance is there and we're ready to go, I don't think it's going to be that big of a.
No, I think it's straightforward if you know where all those pieces are. It's not much work. But if you don't, it's easy to get n minus one of the pieces in place, and you discover them one at a time at sort of the worst possible moment and very expensively. Okay, so those kind of sort of configurational issues, we sort of put on the back burner until we get the core stuff fixed.
So forgive me if I'm wrong about this, but I thought that right now we're actually basically about performance. Zscale is winning some and losing others, right? So it's pretty close, isn't it?
I actually think so. Zscale.
Just a quick update, Alan. So I was talking to Sage earlier, Booster stand up. So I able to make these parallel things working. So that's giving like single OSD almost 2x bump. And throughout the 2 hours run, the thing is that it we are still not comfortable on the parallel stuff, so we are still probably having some issues on the freelist manager. But it's the thing is that Zscale is improving with more parallelism, and the thing is that we have to fix some part on the batching, because even with the parallelism we are seeing some more writes. I will work with Mana today. But it's improving. And also the noticeable thing is that we are gaining probably 30 to 40% on the CPU-wise on the same workload than RocksDB. So that's also a bigger benefit.
My point is that at the cluster level, I think we've actually more than crossed over. The problem is we're measuring single OSD throughput, and you know what we're seeing is we can't saturate a drive with a single OSD, but the resources that we're consuming is much, much less. So, you know, if you partitioned your SSDs and put a bunch of OSDs in a box, I think you'd find your aggregate throughput with Zscale would radically exceed what you get with RocksDB today. It's just that I'm deeply skeptical that having to slice up your single SSD into multiple OSDs is a deployable solution. You know, I can see Sage shaking his head, and I'm completely in agreement with that. It's fine for benchmarking, but it's a deployment. Let's face it, Ceph is already difficult to deploy. Okay, this is just going to square it from an operational perspective.
I think it's a temporary solution until we deal with whatever the scaling, the per process scaling issues are.
I don't know about the per process, but I think just fundamentally today. The current code base really, says one OSD equals one drive. Okay. And, if you want to change that, you can change that, but you got to change it everywhere. Okay. And I think that's going to ripple through a lot of code and a lot of support code and a lot of other stuff. And the simplest solution is to go fix the OSD so that it goes fast. That's going to be much less work.
So, Alan, this is actually why I brought up the BlueFS thing, is because it seems like Zscale is actually already on the performance front getting pretty close to being, on the whole, equivalent or maybe even a slight win compared to RocksDB. So is it time now to start thinking about these kinds of, deployment, ease of deployment issues with it?
I think so. You know, I've been optimistic about Zettascale and for a long time. It's been a long time coming, much longer than I think any of us expected. I think that I'd like to see that. You know, I think that, you know, as I said before, I think it's actually already well crossed over. The other thing to realize is that a lot of the RocksDB performance runs that we're comparing it against are on, frankly, trivially small devices. You know, and the compaction write amp problem with rocks gets worse with the size of the device. Yeah, so I think we sat down the other day, and it looks like, you know, I think around around a 500 gigabyte device that cross over. And I know a lot of our performance tests have been on 100 gigabyte devices just because they're quick and easy. But it ignores the fact that ROX's compaction is scales with the size of the device. And that's really another major problem with it. I think it's a question of the community. You know, how far along does it have to go before, you know, my expectation has been there would be some magical moment where everyone would say, yes, this is the better horse. Let's go jump on it. Okay. And everybody else will jump on it with us. If now is that point, you know, great. Personally, I would have jumped before. We haven't sort of been pounding our feet because there's a lot of other issues outside of the KV store that are affecting our performance, that just switching that is not going to address.
Maybe one of the first steps then would be to have Somnath or someone else just give me a quick rundown on how to get this working in our test environment so we can get more additional, testing happening in our lab as well. But I would like to see this, I think at this point, be easier for the community to start using.
Okay. Well, I think right now what Somnath has said is probably true, which is that the current code, is unstable. It's promising in its performance, but it sounds like the extra parallelism is potentially breaking other things in the code. I suspect those were probably bugs anyways that were latent that because of the different operating mode are happening more frequently now as opposed to less frequently. But we need to get to something that's stable, I think, before the rest of the community is going to be able to dig in with it. So, hopefully,
Single KV sync thread, it's stable, Mark. But you will not see difference probably other than like 1 terabyte volume per OSD. So because like 100 gig, I have data for 100 gig, 500 gig, so that RocksDB is outperforming.
Right, Somnath, that's single OSD. You're not looking at a cluster level, and you're not running it on a system that was CPU saturated before. I think the question.
Actually, I used to have some data
when somebody says yes, don't tell them reasons why they should be saying no. Bad negotiating style.
One of the things that I think will be good here too is that our lab, is fairly different hardware than you guys have, right? I mean, these are Intel NVMe drives. We are definitely CPU limited on these boxes, or very easily can be, given the hardware that's there. So. Regardless of whatever results you have, it'd be good just to get tests running on them so that we can see how similar they look, or who knows, maybe we'll see even better performance than you guys do. Just it'd be good to get repeated tests running on other hardware too.
So I completely agree. I think that I think we're close enough that basically with the results these guys are seeing, I think this is the time. I think it's crossed over, and I think I can show you why it's going to stay crossed over as we go forward.
Okay, cool. I'll do that kind of testing to try to verify what you guys are seeing. But then let's all think about, even if it's only in the back of our heads, what we need to do to actually make this usable for everyone else. Both in terms of you know, whatever documentation we need to write, but then also if there are steps we need to take in the code to make it user friendly as
right.
As
so why don't
hang on, Alan? You guys said it wasn't stable. Do you mean that there are changes you made in BlueSphere that aren't stable, or that there are changes you made in Zettascale that aren't stable?
I think what's happening.
It's not BlueSphere. It's in the shim, Sam. It's in the Zettascale store that the shim layer we have written. Zettascale itself is stable, so that no issue on that. So.
Okay, sorry. It's in the plugin thing you use to adapt that scale to work with. Yeah. BlueSphere, fine. So, what's your strategy?
There are some issues on that. Yeah, but now actually that's a separate thing. We have to for scaling up. So we are making BlueSphere everything said multi-threaded. That's why it's having some issues within the BlueSphere itself. Means it's not set. So we have to make
that's
it work.
Definitely not stable.
That doesn't even sound like a good idea. From what Sage was just describing earlier.
Yeah, I mean, I think the rationale seems to be that if you have a lot of energy that needs to make, somebody has a whole bunch of noise here. I can't really hear anything.
Sounds like an airplane.
Oh, Sam. It sounds like the rationale would be that if we have a lot of transactions to apply to the Zettascale B-tree, and we literally can't do them serially, we need to do them in parallel in order to keep the latency down. Like, that seems like the only reason why we would want parallel KV sync threads. But beyond
I think that's correct. And I think that we need to think that through carefully so that they get batched up properly. Okay, I don't think it's trivial.
I think it's orthogonal from batching, because KV sync thread is already batching perfectly, right? It's single iteration. Yeah. It gives you a big pile of transactions, says do these all together all at once. So the batching is already done. I mean, maybe the interface is making that not work, and I think that should be fixed independently.
So we can do it. You're gonna leave a fair amount of performance on the table
So there are performance details to work out, but I think my larger point was that I don't want to go to the trouble of stabilizing RocksDB if we're going to switch to Zettascale. So I think you guys should absolutely focus on stabilizing something that works and getting all of the community enablement tools working so that people can start testing it and that we can put it in the lab.
Well, I think kind of what I suggested, Sam.
But you also suggested that it should perhaps wait until the performance is better. I don't think that's a good idea.
Well, we're going to need RocksDB anyway for disks.
I think the question is I agree we need to continue to stabilize the code. There's no question about that. The question is when do we engage with the ancillary support in order to enable other people to use it in a convenient fashion? I would have liked to have done that months ago, but I didn't feel like we had the evidence to do that, and I believe we do now, so I'm in complete agreement. The question is how do we do that? I was going to suggest perhaps a separate meeting rather than tying up this team on this particular subject to go through the details of the enablement, because I don't think we here at Western Digital can enumerate all of the specific deployment things that need to get done. Okay, that's so the question is can we form a team with some people? We can put some people in it, Sage, if you could find one or two people who can finish that enumeration, then we can sit down and figure out how to get all those pieces is done in a timely fashion.
Yep. I think we just put a meeting on the calendar for later this week or early next week, and we can go through that. I mean, this is that we're mostly talking about how to make Zettascale coexist on the same block device as the rest of BlueStore, similar to what RocksDB is doing, like the BlueFS piece, right?
Yeah, I mean, it's how do you provision Zettascale? How do you provision Zettascale instead of BlueStore? And what steps you have to go through and blah blah blah.
No, instead of RocksDB, right?
Thank you. Instead of Rocks. Yeah. Yes. Yep. Okay. Now, what about Friday? What about Friday morning? And who should be on the list?
Me. I don't know. Okay. Who else at Red Hat?
I don't think there's that much to it, right? You need to write a shim layer so that it speaks BlueFS, and then you need to make sure the config option shows up where it needs to show up.
Yeah,
because BlueStore is going to be what sets up Zettascale. It's not like you need to externally set it up.
Yeah. Yep, and BlueStar is already like looking at whether it's rotational or not, and so my assumption is just that it'll say if it's rotational, use RocksDB. If it's not, then use Zscaler. It'd be a simple enough heuristic, unless you explicitly specify.
So, quick question, right? Why we want to? I mean, I understood that okay, BlueFS is sharing spaces between data device and all, but if we calculate the metadata properly, and then if we give a big enough DB space, so won't that be enough to run Zscaler on its own?
It's a deployment. Yeah. It's a deployment nightmare. Absolutely, no one's going to calculate that correctly, and people are going to run out of either metadata space or data space without running out of the other.
More importantly, you can have an OSD that's 100% key value data.
Well, I have a
RGW index in a separate pool, and it's all OMAP data. So it has to be dynamic no matter what. We can't have a fixed allocation.
We recognized this issue 6 months ago and tabled it until we could get to the point that we're at today, which is to establish that it is the preferred alternative on some environments. We will have to revisit Zscaler in order to figure out how to make it work in the dynamic environment. It's not a trivial amount of work, but I don't think it's a difficult piece of work. Okay. Yeah. But it is work that has to get done before it's production worthy. I think what is true is that we probably are going to have to live for a period of time with a fixed allocation.
No one's going to deploy it that way. The only way you'll be able to use it that way is in a benchmarking.
I completely agree with you.
For development purposes. Yeah.
It's for development purposes. Okay. I agree with you. It is not a production solution.
So I think the big question
hard to set up and also
I don't think it's I don't know, means it's only probably related to the blog. If you are keeping the RocksDB, I don't think for object and bigger workload Zscaler makes sense. So if we and block will not be having that metadata, that amount of metadata. So I don't know.
Some method doesn't matter. We have to crack the dynamic allocation problem before it's going to be widespread deployable. I mean, there's just too much that you're expecting people to be able to predict about their environments from a group of people that simply don't have the data. I mean, we can't turn deploying Ceph into a freaking science experiment. I should let me rephrase that. It's a science experiment today. I don't want to turn it into a quantum physics exercise.
Sorry for interrupting. Sorry, I got to have another meeting to jump in. So there's a question for Seth and Sam. So right now we have a different type of workload, and they need it fast, and they don't care what the data needs or not. And we actually tune one big cluster with more than, you know, hundreds of server nodes. And with one duplicate, and from time to time, it's okay to talk with the data nodes. But of course, we're going to have a clear definition of how we're going to allow the data nodes. But the question is, once we lose the data, we got lots of warnings. And we think this loose data is normal. So how are we going to tune the Ceph cluster to allow to have some tolerance of data loose? First of all, is that possible? Second one is how are we going to tune
it? It's possible, but I think it's a whole nother conversation that is probably hard to address right now. I think what would be helpful if we send an email to the list that summarizes what the data workload looks like and under what circumstances you expect you would lose data and what you expect to happen when that happens.
Okay, sure.
And then we can discuss it on the list. I think that'll be more effective.
Okay, cool. And the second question will be, so far are we going to have a thousand of containers going to move to their Ceph cluster? So we are right now working on several volume managers. So from Ceph perspective, do you guys have any recommendation of what kind of volume manager you guys going to choose? Or
can you describe what you mean by volume manager?
Huh?
Can you tell us what you mean by volume manager?
So some volume manager like a Flocker, like a Word plugin from Comtiv, or from you know the Rancher OS, they also have their own volume managers. So the 10 types of volume managers.
And so a volume in this case is an independent file namespace?
It's going to
for a container that has different permissions and whatever else, like a subvolume?
This is not going to be a file. Actually, the volume manager is going to provision the Ceph storage with the APIs, so their Docker in outside is going to use this API the warnings and the migration to snapshot also can
start. There's a Ceph volume manager project that we started like a year ago that is used for Manila. Ideally, that would be the tool that you would use. It sets up CephFS subdirectories with all the permissions and all that stuff, and it has an API for doing snapshots and so on. So I think that would be the project to use, assuming it sort of fits the bill. And if it doesn't, then we should figure out how it doesn't and whether it should be changed. But that's the place to start. Mm-hmm. CephFS volume.
And so far, we are evaluating a wall plugin, which is from the Contiv. Actually, it's part of Cisco. And so far, it's kind of stable. And just to share with you guys of this kind of information. And for sure, we need to work more on that. Yeah. And there's a third question to problem to Sam. Because right now we care about TCO. First of all, our deployment is all about SSD. And the second one, we also want to have TCO benefits as well. So we care lots of EC, and we want to know what's the progress of the RBD with the EC.
I mean, I think I emailed you, but yeah, it's merged. It's extremely experimental, and I'm not committing to the disk format. So don't count it up. So you're free to benchmark it.
Yeah, we definitely want to benchmark, and I'm probably going to connect you in the email to see how we're going to benchmark in our cluster.
Well, if you look at the Ceph QA suite branch, you'll see the commands needed to do it. I suggest you follow that.
Okay. So where? Can you see it again?
If you look at the pull request that merged it, there was a Ceph QA suite branch that went in at the same time.
Okay.
And then today or tomorrow, I'll merge a fix to the RBD tree.
Okay.
Ceph QA suite tree that will enable tests there. You can do the same commands.
Great. Okay. I'm going to follow up with that. Okay. Thank you. Thank you. That's pretty much all the question. Thank you.
The request is in the chat. The link to the volume client.
Hey, Sage, I had a question for you back kind of the previous conversation. If in Zettascale we got to write a head log, and kind of given that there's a fairly low metadata or lower metadata workload and we have a large Minalloc size, do you think that that would ever be sufficient for spinning disks? Do we still need RocksDB?
That's the question for Alan. I don't know. I don't know how Zettascale would behave on disks.
Crappy. I'm going to be honest. This whole time, I've kind of assumed that we're going to find that Zettascale performs better on disks. I know that it's not going to be as fast in terms of straight line performance for random updates, but that's only because you're deferring most of the work with RocksDB to later. I think you'll get slower but more predictable throughput, and that may actually be massively.
Yeah, there's actually some continued development work going on in Zettascale that squares the circle. They're looking at a mode where it would be writing sequential and then do garbage collection of its own flavor, but not LSM style, okay? And that's in proof of concept phase today. But Sam may be entirely right about it. I think we'll sort of have to see what it looks like. My guess is that Sam is probably right, which is that for really large volumes, the compaction overhead with rocks, is gonna suck. Okay. The only saving grace with that is odds are pretty good that on a hard drive, the kinds of data that are out there is gonna have a lower metadata load. Okay.
I don't think that's true. That's kind of my point. With those RGW workloads where people want just oceans and oceans of objects, you get some big objects and it does suck up a lot of the disk, but you also get a ton of really tiny objects. I think actually that with those disk workloads, your metadata traffic is going to be extremely high.
Well, I certainly in the
we've seen it with some users with file store. They hit split thresholds that aren't plausible unless they're storing very, very small Rados GW objects. I think it's actually very common.
I understand, and the issue of really small objects is an interesting issue that ripples through the system. I will tell you that while this is an interesting part of the system, I'm skeptical that the current rebuild strategies are viable for that kind
of use case. I'm not worried about that so much. All I'm pointing out is that there will be a lot stored in RocksDB, and that compaction will be non-trivial. So a system with predictable worst case update properties would be preferable there to what RocksDB.
I understand there are further
optimizations that could be done, but I think that one alone would be worthwhile.
I'm sure there are a lot of cases where you're right. We don't need to argue about how many.
That question originally was that I think there are cases here where we might actually be looking at Zeta scale on disk, right? Rather than on spinning disks. It's not necessarily that.
Which is why I'm pointing out that. Yeah. We should, as quickly as possible, get it to the point where it works properly with BlueFS and is integrated to a point where most people can benchmark it, and not just you.
We're all in agreement on that, okay? It's just a matter of getting people motivated to do that, and I'm glad to see the uptick of interest in the community around this.
All right, let's get some testing done. Let's get it through my test too, and that'll be the first step, and we can be thinking about BlueFS, and maybe this will be a big turning point. We'll see.
So Mark, I think you can I can point you that branch and how to do that. I had to sync it with the latest master and then send it out. So it's just doing a make and make install, and it should work as is. So we fixed all those things. So, and it should be able to do. There is not much configuration you need. I'll send you the instruction once I sync it with the latest master. But it will be still in single KV sync thread. So I'm not going to give you that multi-sync because it's fine. But you can give me the preliminary data on the NVMe drives.
Absolutely. All right. Well, does anyone else have anything for this week that they'd like to discuss?
Don't think so.
All right. Well, then have a great week, everyone, and we'll see you next week.
See you guys. Thanks.
Thanks.